By May 1471, the Wars of the Roses had blighted the country for 16 years. But now the Lancastrian cause lay in tatters on the bloody field of Tewkesbury. The Lancastrian nobility had been butchered during the battle or executed in its aftermath. Edward, Prince of Wales, was among the dead. Queen Margaret of Anjou was a prisoner of King Edward IV. The convenient death of the old King Henry VI in the Tower of London less than 3 weeks later at last secured the crown for Edward, and a Yorkist golden age was about to be ushered in. Lurking in the wings, however, was the king's youngest brother, Richard, Duke of Gloucester, a man whose hardness of heart was remarkable even by the standards of this ruthless age. He was not only to emerge as one of English history's most controversial characters, he was also to take center stage for the bloody climax to the Wars of the Roses.
After the readaption, Edward IV and the Yorkists can really breathe a sigh of relief, and Edward is now free to show himself the effective political leader that we've all along suggested that he was.
Edward's policies in the second reign were in fact almost exactly the same as in his first reign, but the absence of Lancastrian opposition meant that he was simply more secure and, to put it crudely, could perhaps get away with more.
So now Edward could look forward to a long and challenged reign. And after all, he was still not quite 30. And also, he now had a male heir born while he was in exile. For the White Rose, the future looked very rosy indeed.
A smooth succession to the throne therefore appeared to have been secured. The only small cloud on the horizon for Edward came in the shape of Henry Tudor, the Earl of Richmond, who had escaped to Brittany in September 1471.
Henry Tudor fled to Brittany with his uncle Jasper Tudor as a result of their participation in the fighting in Wales that followed on from Edward's victory at Tewkesbury. In other words, they were renegade Lancastrian magnates fleeing the collapse of the Lancastrian readaption of Henry VI. Henry Tudor's claim to the throne came through his mother, Margaret Beaufort. Through her, he inherited the Beaufort claim, that is to say, the claim of the illegitimate children of John of Gaunt, father of Henry IV, and therefore the source of the Lancastrian claim to the throne. So it's a sort of sub-claim attached to the Lancastrian claim.
Edward ruled England autocratically, but in this unusual and welcome period of peace, the country and the crown prospered. There was something of a commercial boom, a significant increase in imports and exports, and mutually profitable business relationships with bankers in London. Edward proved himself to be a generous and cultivated king, although he was, by all accounts, a notorious glutton and womanizer. One anonymous contemporary chronicler was obviously less than impressed.
In food and drink, he was immoderate. He sometimes took an emetic to gorge his stomach. He was licentious in the extreme, insolent to numerous women after he had seduced them, and pursued with no discrimination the married and the unmarried, the noble and the lowly. However, he took none by force.
Edward took many mistresses, the best known of whom was Elizabeth Shaw, sometimes called Jane Shaw, the wife of a London goldsmith. In all, Edward fathered at least 10 known illegitimate children. The king was quick to reward loyal supporters such as William Hastings, who was made a Garter Knight and appointed Master of the Mint. Showing a remarkable capacity for forgiveness, Edward even forgave his wayward brother, the Duke of Clarence, bestowing upon him the earldoms of Warwick and Salisbury, and the post of Great Chamberlain. Edward may have tried to restore family harmony, but the Duke of Clarence and Duke of Gloucester were in no mood to follow suit. They had their own personal quarrel.
Now, ostensibly, this quarrel was about the division of the Earl of Warwick's inheritance. Clarence was married to the elder daughter of the Earl of Warwick, and Gloucester, in 1472, married the younger daughter. And this meant that Clarence would have to share the enormous Warwick-Salisbury inheritance, the Neville inheritance. However, I think there's actually a deeper cause to this quarrel, which arises from Clarence's own questionable behaviour in causing the readaptation in the first place and the resulting insecurity that he felt when Edward was brought back to power in the 1470s. I think this made him rather jealous of Gloucester and rather nervous about Gloucester's influence, because Gloucester, of course, had supported his brother during the readaptation, was now rewarded with lands in the north and had a very secure place in Edward's regime. Clarence was that little bit less secure, however friendly the king was to him on the surface.
There were enough reminders of past troubles to ensure that Edward did not drop his guard, and in 1472 came proof positive that the country's military troubles were not over. This time, it was Lord Oxford who, with the help of Louis XI of France, harried Edward and forced him to act.
What Edward really had to do to deal with threats like that posed by the Earl of Oxford was to convince everybody that there was nothing to be gained from returning to uncertainty and division. What he does on this occasion is round up those people he thinks may be involved in plotting and strut about the place, making himself powerful and strong, as it were. Specifically in the West Country, he offers pardons to all of those who are with Oxford if they return to allegiance. And Oxford's small, anyway, army disintegrates pretty quickly. The fact that the West Country doesn't rise means that he has no hope, really, of continuing with this exploit. And so he himself is forced to surrender fairly quickly.
Lord Oxford's estates were confiscated and passed on to Richard, Duke of Gloucester. The enthusiastic Tudor propagandist William Shakespeare significantly shaped the popular modern image of Richard as a deformed despot, although there is little contemporary evidence to back him up. Richard may perhaps have been born with one shoulder slightly higher than the other, but he was certainly not the crookback so gleefully depicted in the Bard's play.
I am that curtailed of this fair proportion, cheated of feature by dissembling nature, deformed, unfinished, sent before my time into this breathing world, scarce half made up, and that so lamely and unfashionable, the dogs bark at me as I halt them.
He was, however, utterly ruthless and consumed by greed. Character traits that were clearly illustrated by the shameful way in which Lord Oxford's frail, aging mother was physically bullied into signing her estates over to Richard. Such calculating behaviour was remarkable for a man who had barely turned 20. Although there was domestic stability during Edward's reign, the complex wranglings of continental politics continued. In 1477, Duke Charles of Burgundy was killed in battle, leaving as his only heir Mary of Burgundy, his daughter by a previous marriage. The Duke's death signified the collapse of one of Europe's most fashionable and powerful courts. and it also left England's stronghold of Calais open to attack. Marriage plans have been proposed between Mary of Burgundy and the recently widowed Duke of Clarence. But with the delicate political position very much in mind, King Edward advised against it. Once again, the aspirations of the bitter and unstable Clarence were thwarted, and he soon once more became an irksome and irritating problem for Edward.
When Edward refuses to marry Clarence to Mary of Burgundy in 1477 following Charles the Bold's death, I think this sets the seal on Clarence's sense of exclusion, really, from the opportunities of the regime. And Clarence either participates in a series of rather extravagant misbehaviours at this time. There are allegations of plots involving sorcery emanating from one of his esquires. There's an incredible case of judicial murder, which Clarence is very clearly implicated in Warwickshire. Or if he's not actually doing these rather wayward and wild things, it is easy enough for the king to pin this kind of behaviour on him.
In July 1477, Edward finally lost patience with his quarrelsome brother, and Clarence was arrested and sent to the Tower. In January of the following year, a bill of attainder was issued against the Duke, accusing him of treason and plotting to usurp the throne. Clarence was sentenced to death.
Edward IV was hell-bent on destroying his brother. This was a personal vendetta. And the Crowland Chronicler records that in the trial that nobody spoke against the Duke except the King, and nobody answered the King except the Duke. The arrest, the arraignment, the trial and the execution of the Duke of Clarence was a responsibility of one man, and one man only, Edward IV.
There's no evidence at all that Gloucester was directly implicated in the sense of pulling strings to bring about Clarence's condemnation. He hardly needed to. But I think it is true to say that Edward could not have proceeded to the death of one brother without at least the tacit approval of the other.
With Clarence out of the way, and with two legitimate sons amongst his heirs, Edward's position was settled at last. There were the usual feuds within the court, not least of which was the hostile relationship between Edward's favourite minister, William Hastings, and the Queen's brother, Anthony Woodville, the second Earl Rivers. Hastings found his position increasingly threatened as he became more and more at odds with the notorious Woodvilles. As for the King, he was now very different to the athletic and vigorous man who had fought so hard to gain the throne. Advancing towards middle age, Edward's well-known gluttony had caught up with him. He had grown very corpulent indeed, and he was no longer able to exercise. However, his voracious sexual appetite was, by all accounts, unaffected. In March 1483, everything suddenly changed when King Edward was taken gravely ill after a fishing trip. Certain that he was on his deathbed, Edward laid careful plans for the kingdom. He named his eldest son Edward the Prince of Wales, only 12 years old, as the heir to the throne, nominating his brother, Richard of Gloucester, as Lord Protector during the boy's minority. On the 9th of April 1483, Edward IV died, aged 41, and an unknown chronicler recorded the king's dying words.
Wherefore, in these last words that I ever speak to you, I exhort you and require you all for the love that you have ever borne me, for the love that I have ever borne you, for the love that our Lord beareth to us all from this time forward, all griefs forgotten. Each of you love each other.
The chances of the king's last wishes ever coming true were, of course, very remote indeed.
Edward's death must have led to extreme anxiety amongst courtiers and councillors, and there was so much bad blood existing between the people at the heart of government, between the members of the Woodville family and men like Hastings, who was the head of Edward's household. And there were other figures too, Richard of Gloucester, who was based in the north, his role had still to be decided, despite his brother Edward declaring him protector on his deathbed.
The Woodvilles, and in particular Earl Rivers, the uncle to whom Edward was devoted, were far from happy with the idea of the Duke of Gloucester as sole protector. And so they ignored the king's last wishes, establishing instead a council of regency of which the Duke was merely a figurehead.
Richard was in the north when Edward died, but he rapidly headed south, presumably intent upon ensuring that he did play a central role in the government of the young king.
Richard was undoubtedly horrified by the actions of the Woodville family following his brother's death. The Queen failed to appraise her brother-in-law of what had happened, and she sought to sideline him by having her son crowned as quickly as possible. Once crowned, the status of a protector will be very reduced.
Because of his hatred of the Woodvilles, and through a continued loyalty to the dead king, William Hastings became a close supporter of the Duke of Gloucester. Meanwhile, the Woodvilles found themselves in a position of unrivaled power, and Earl Rivers, his younger brother Edward, and his nephew, the Marquis of Dorset, a son of the widowed queen through a previous marriage, became the dominant political characters at court.
All the powerful figures in England depend more closely than they have before on the king for the preservation of their power. The Woodvilles are a wholly king-made family, but so also, of course, is Richard of Gloucester. He has some of his own estates and some in right of his wife, but a lot of his power in the north depend on continued backing from the centre. So Gloucester needs control of the prince, but the prince is in the hands of the Woodvilles, and the Woodvilles need control of the prince, possibly to protect them against Gloucester.
As the jostling for position gathered pace, support for Richard centred upon the Duke of Buckingham, who had also developed a powerful dislike of Rivers and his unpopular clique. Buckingham took troops to rendezvous with the Duke of Gloucester at Northampton, where, in April 1483, the armed force intercepted and seized the young Prince of Wales en route to London for his coronation as Edward V. Earl Rivers, Dorset's younger brother, Richard Grey, and the King's Chamberlain, Sir Thomas Vaughan, were all arrested and sent under guard to Pontefract, where, on Gloucester's orders, they would later be beheaded without even the pretense of a trial. Edward IV's widow, Queen Elizabeth, received the news of her son's abduction with horror, and fled with the 10-year-old Duke of York, taking sanctuary at Westminster. Richard of Gloucester arrived in London with the young king on the 4th of May, 1483, and somehow managed to convince Parliament to confirm him as Lord Protector.
It suited Gloucester to argue that to be protector was his right, and that was what was appropriate, and that was what would be good for the prince. And with the prince in his possession, I don't think anyone could really gainsay him. He moved quickly to identify the Woodvilles as a problem group and to remove them from power, and also to remove key allies of theirs. And he also moved quickly to build up the Duke of Buckingham in strength. So all those figures from the Edwardian establishment in London must have been thinking, this is the new dispensation, Gloucester wants to be protector, we have to go with that. And I think that really explains why they were willing to accept him in that role.
There is little doubt that by now, Gloucester had fully formulated his plan to seize the throne for himself. A major problem had already identified itself. There were several members of the Regency Council who simply would not countenance a plan to remove the king. Chief among these was Lord Hastings, the faithful friend and supporter of the late Edward IV. On the 12th of June, 1483, Lord Stanley, another member of the Regency Council, is supposed to have had an ominous dream that was so disturbing that, in the middle of the night, he sent word to Hastings urging him to escape to safety. If this story is true, Hastings should have heeded the advice. The very next morning, Hastings, Stanley, Sir Thomas Howard, the Duke of Buckingham, Archbishop Rotherham and Bishop Morton of Ely all met at the Tower to discuss the final details of Edward V's coronation. Gloucester joined them at about 9 o'clock and seemed in good enough humour. However, he soon left the meeting, and when he returned an hour later, the Duke's demeanour was very different indeed.
Hastings was then suddenly accused of treason. A group of armed men who'd been waiting in the adjoining room rushed in, dragged him out off to the Tower of London, where he was summarily executed. It's one of the most shocking murders, really, of the entire Wars of the Roses period.
The news of the brutal and swift execution of Lord Hastings soon leaked out to the general public, who heard the news with amazement. Nothing could have surely merited such treatment of a respected and senior figure. Nothing, that is, except a plot against the Lord Protector, for which the architect had been punished, and this was the version of events that Gloucester put around. No evidence to support Gloucester's explanation for Hastings' death has ever been uncovered.
Richard, during the 6 or 7 weeks before he seized the crown, realised that he'd already gone too far, that by putting Rivers and the other Woodvilles into captivity, he was storing up trouble for himself in the future. Because what would happen in a few years' time when young Edward V became king in his own right? How would he then react to his uncle Richard, who had captured his relatives, forced his mother to run into sanctuary? And it's possible that during those weeks, Richard realised that actually he'd already dug himself a hole and that he had to get out of this. And the only way he could get out was by taking the crown itself.
On the 16th of June, just 3 days after Hastings' death, the Duke of Buckingham and a party of nobles arrived at Westminster to remove Edward's younger brother, the Duke of York, from the sanctuary of Westminster Abbey. The two young princes were installed in apartments in the Tower, and their fate was sealed. On the 22nd of June, 1483, a propaganda sermon by Dr. Ralph Shaw at St. Paul's Cross preached that, owing to a broken betrothal to Eleanor Butler, Edward IV's marriage to Elizabeth Woodville had been invalid, and therefore his heirs, including the current boy king, were illegitimate. It was, of course, an outrageous suggestion. Following the sermon, the Duke of Buckingham mounted his own carefully calculated smear campaign, condemning the dead king's sexual infidelities. 3 days later, a delegation headed by Buckingham formally petitioned the Duke of Gloucester to take the throne and rule as Richard III. Gloucester played the game to perfection and at first modestly refused to accept the crown. But of course, he soon allowed the facade to crumble. Gloucester finally agreed to take the crown, and he was proclaimed king only a day later. He was crowned King Richard III on the 6th of July, 1483. The two child princes in the Tower would never be seen again.
There is no positive evidence for the murder of Edward IV's two sons, the princes in the Tower, but they disappear from view very thoroughly in the late summer of 1483. And by far the most likely scenario is that Richard has had them murdered.
There's no written evidence, no single document that allows us to pin the responsibility for the murders of the princes in the Tower upon Richard. And those that defend him will point that out. But there's other kinds of historical evidence besides documents. And I think the clinching argument for Richard's responsibility are the actions of those who were at the court in 1483. These were the members of Edward IV's household, the men who'd been loyal Yorkists for years. They now turned against Richard. Now, why should they do that? After all, some of them had fought alongside him at Barnet and Tewkesbury. This was a man they had trusted. And they turn against him, and they support Henry Tudor, somebody they didn't know at all. Now, the actions of those men seems to be the best evidence that at the time, people believed Richard was responsible for his nephew's murders.
His four main supporters, the Duke of Buckingham, Henry Percy, the fourth Earl of Northumberland, Lord Howard, now created Duke of Norfolk, and Lord Stanley, now surrounded Richard. Stanley's decision to make peace with Richard was influenced by his marriage to Margaret Beaufort, the mother of Henry Tudor. To defend himself from accusations of treason and protect the lives of his wife and Lancastrian stepson, Stanley agreed to back Richard's coronation as king.
Despite events in London, Richard was still popular, particularly in the north. Clearly, he was greeted with delight in York in the summer of 1483 when he visited the city on progress. And there's other evidence from that summer of him being welcomed in other cities. But overall, we're really trying to build a big picture on small snippets of evidence. The really big, important picture is that Richard had already failed in the prime requirement of a medieval king. What a king was expected to do was to give peace and stability to his people. But by usurping the throne in June 1483, all Richard had done was condemn England to another 2 years of rebellion and uncertainty.
It was impossible for King Richard to shake off the rumours that not only were the two young princes no longer alive, but that he had been responsible for their deaths. There were several opportunities for him to parade them in public in order to put an end to the speculation. But, of course, he did not do so. There was no escaping the fact that Richard had usurped the throne in brutal, bloody circumstances. Now, old Lancastrian sympathies among the English nobility were rekindled. The Red Rose had one surviving champion, a man whose own claim to the throne was tenuous, but strong enough to challenge Richard. He was Henry Tudor.
The choice of Henry Tudor as the rebels' alternative claimant to the throne is inconceivable if it weren't believed that the princes were dead.
Henry Tudor became the leader of the Yorkist-Lancaster alliance simply because there was nobody else. The members of Edward IV's Yorkist household would much preferred to have rebelled in the cause of Edward V, but they must have known that he was dead. And so, desperately, they gave their loyalty to Henry Tudor. This was a case of better the devil that you don't know than the devil, Richard, that you do.
Support for the reborn Lancastrian cause came from the unlikeliest of quarters. The Duke of Buckingham, doughty supporter and one-time henchman of Richard, added his name to the long list of English nobles who had swapped sides during the time of the Wars of the Roses. Why he did so remains unclear to this very day, but there is some evidence that he was influenced by the Lancastrian supporter, Bishop Morton. Bishop Morton had been intriguing for some time with Margaret Beaufort, the mother of Henry Tudor, and almost incredibly, it was not too long before Buckingham had switched his allegiance and was backing Tudor's planned uprising. Elizabeth Woodville, the former queen of Edward IV, secured more support by offering her daughter, Elizabeth of York, as a potential bride for Henry Tudor, strengthening not only the unlikely Yorkist-Lancastrian alliance, but also Henry's claim to the crown. The great uprising against King Richard was planned to begin on the 18th of October, 1483. There were to be a wave of small-scale rebellions in the southeast of England, which included an army from Kent making a feigned attack on London that was intended to distract King Richard. Meanwhile, Buckingham's troops would join with Welsh forces in the West Country. It was planned that Henry Tudor himself would then land in Dorset with an army of Breton troops.
The 1483 rebellion against Richard III never, in fact, came to battle. It dissolved, and one consequence of that is that many of the rebels survived to fight another day.
The 1483 rebellion was such a disaster, it's hard to say that it ever really had much chance of success. It was blighted by poor communications right across the south. Then Buckingham, who was a late entrant into the rebellion, was caught the wrong side of the Severn by appalling weather conditions and had no chance to take part. And Richard's reaction was swift and effective. So the rebels scattered before any effective opposition had developed to Richard. The whole process was over before Henry Tudor appeared off the south coast.
The Duke of Buckingham's treachery took him to the block in the city of Salisbury, while Bishop Morton, the man who reputedly had done more than anyone to convince Buckingham to switch sides, managed to escape abroad. The Croyland Chronicle recorded the Duke's end.
The Duke was seized and taken to the city of Salisbury, where the King had arrived with a great army. He suffered capital punishment in the public marketplace of that city on All Souls' Day, notwithstanding the fact that it fell on a Sunday that year.
Despite the failure of the rebellion, pro-Tudor feeling in the country continued to grow. Although Richard proved to be a fine administrator, he was simply an unpopular monarch.
Richard apparently had won, but even his success then led to real problems. The gentry who'd rebelled fled to join Henry Tudor in Brittany, leaving great gaps in the local government of the south of England. And Richard had a problem. How did he fill these gaps? His solution, in many cases, was to transplant his northern supporters to the south, men like Edward Redman, whose effigy can still be seen in Harwood House in Yorkshire. Redman, whose lands were in the Lake District in West Yorkshire, finds himself in government deep down in the southwest. What was it like for that man to undertake such a role? We know what the southerners felt. They were extremely hostile to these northern intruders, and all that did was just add to the hostility to Richard.
In April 1484, personal tragedy came to blight Richard's life when Edward, his only legitimate son, died suddenly at Middleham Castle. He was just 10 years old, and the King and Queen were overcome with grief at the boy's death. The Croyland Chronicle noted that
the King learned how vain are the attempts to regulate his affairs without God. In April, his only son, on whom all hope of a royal succession rested, died after a short illness. You might have seen his mother and father after hearing the news at Nottingham, almost out of their minds when faced with the sudden grief.
Within months, the Queen too had succumbed to illness, although there is little evidence that this time Richard was bereft. In fact, rumours circulated that he had poisoned the Queen in order to marry his niece, Elizabeth of York, Edward IV's eldest daughter.
Anne Neville dies, of course, very suddenly at a young age, and that inspires rumours that she may have been done away with, but it's hard to see how it could possibly have been in Richard's interest to remove this young wife of his, who was still very much of childbearing age, when it would have mattered to him so much to try and obtain an heir. And he can solve the problem that Elizabeth of York is being betrothed to Henry Tudor, in Henry Tudor's own mind at least, by marrying her off to almost anybody else. He also would have been unlikely, I think, to want to marry somebody he had declared as illegitimate as part of his own claim to the throne. So it's a story that doesn't really add up. It's a slur against Richard, I think.
If Richard had planned to make the throne more secure by marrying, he was to be sorely disappointed. There was outrage among the nobility and common people alike when the marriage was suggested, forcing Richard into the humiliating position of not only having to deny that he intended to take his niece for a wife, but also that he had poisoned the Queen. It seemed that Henry Tudor's challenge for the crown could not be ended by political intrigue. It would have to be ended on the battlefield. Richard did not have long to wait. By 1485, Henry Tudor had re-equipped himself for another invasion of England.
When Henry Tudor returns to England in August 1485, he is clearly claiming to be king. And he returns with a small army from the continent of mercenaries that he's been able to pick up in Normandy, plus those refugees from the Yorkist regime who fled Richard and who may, when they return to England, be able to activate connections of theirs from the regions of their estates. He's also hoping to get the aid of the Stanleys when he reaches the Welsh borders. His mother has, of course, married into that family, and they're the major magnate family of the northwest of England.
Henry's small army first marched into Shropshire, where they began to gather more supporters. Henry had expected the help of his stepfather, Thomas Stanley, who was also King Richard's advisor, but he pointedly refused to join the rebels. However, Stanley also made an excuse when Richard summoned him to a council of war at Nottingham, claiming that he had a stomach complaint. By now, the king was highly suspicious of Stanley and his dubious loyalty, and so he decided to arrest his son, Lord Strange, and to hold him hostage. Perhaps it was no surprise that Strange cracked under the strain, and he soon confessed to being a Tudor supporter. What was more, he also confirmed that his uncle, William Stanley, was involved in the rebellion. Thomas Stanley, though, could not be implicated, and so the king had no choice but to march to face Henry Tudor's rebel army without him.
The positioning of the armies at Bosworth, and indeed the positioning of the whole battle, is a matter continually in dispute among historians, and there's been some very recent changes of view. But I think the basic picture of Richard at the top of a hill and Henry down below, but somewhat protected by an area of marshland, is nonetheless accepted. We also have to recognise that there are a whole series of magnates stationed quite nearby the action, but hedging their bets about whether or not they'll participate. And of course, the key group of magnates here are the Stanleys, who are just to one side with really quite a large army. Richard's army is about twice the size of Henry's, but if the Stanleys choose to commit to Henry's, then the balance between the two forces is much more equal. Also, of course, the Stanleys' force is big enough to intervene decisively for one side or the other in the middle of the battle once the melee has started.
On August 22nd, 1485, King Richard positioned his army on the ridge of Ambion Hill near Bosworth in Leicestershire. They were atop a steep incline with marshland at the foot. And to Henry's troops, the royal army must have looked very formidable indeed. There was a body of archers commanded by the Duke of Norfolk with heavy artillery behind them. Beyond these were King Richard and his men-at-arms, backed by the Earl of Northumberland and his 3,000 northern troops. Surely, Henry's men, with no real artillery and few archers, stood very little chance of victory. But the presence of 4,000 men-at-arms under the command of the Stanley brothers, Thomas and William, threw a rather different aspect on the coming battle. To which side would they offer their support? Richard was concerned enough to threaten the immediate execution of Lord Strange unless Thomas Stanley joined his ranks. But Stanley is reputed to have replied that, as he had two other sons and would not be joining, the king should do his worst. Strange escaped the wrath of the king. One of the most crucial battles in English history was now just a few short minutes away. It was to be a day when the turncoat and the traitor played a role every bit as vital as the common soldier with bill and blade. Soon, the ranks of the men under Richard's ally, Duke of Norfolk, and the Lancastrian Earl of Oxford were joined in a desperate life or death struggle. It was to be the battle-hardened Norfolk's last fight as a stray arrow struck him down. This was a grave loss to Richard's cause. With the Stanley brothers still an ominous presence on the sidelines, the outcome of the battle remained in the balance after an hour of bloody fighting.
The tide turned against Richard when he charged thunderously down Ambion Hill, which had been called the swan song of English medieval chivalry. He'd seen Tudor and was determined to eliminate him.
Until that point, it looked as if Richard might well be successful, even though Northumberland had not committed his men to the conflict. Richard's last cavalry charge had taken him right into the heart of Henry Tudor's household. He'd bowled over Henry's supporters, and briefly, Richard and Henry came face to face and sword to sword. It looked as if Richard was going to win, and even Polydore Virgil, Henry Tudor's own historian, was forced to admit that Henry lasted longer than his own men expected. But he didn't have to last too long. At the crucial moment, Stanley's men tore into the side of Richard's force. Richard was bowled over, and soon he was dead. The story has it that when Richard died, the crown rolled from his head into the base of a thorn bush, and from there it was picked up and used to crown Henry Tudor, King Henry VII. Well, if you go to Westminster Abbey, you can see the crown and the thorn bush amongst the many Tudor badges on display. So there does seem to be a good chance that this legend, at any rate, is based on truth.
There is no contemporary or later Tudor story that confirms that the crown was plucked from a thorn bush. In fact, it was found on the field of battle. If it had been plucked from the thorn bush, I'm sure William Shakespeare would have made much of it and created some lovely lines around it. However, the hawthorn was a heraldic device of Henry VII, and it was carved on his tomb. So this was perhaps the inspiration for a later, perhaps a 17th or 18th century writer.
Henry Tudor was acclaimed King of England on Bosworth Field. The mutilated body of the dead King Richard was stripped naked and unceremoniously carried on horseback through the cheering crowds of the nearby city of Leicester. Not everyone was pleased to hear of the king's demise, however. At York, where Richard had enjoyed so much support during his life, the city council recorded that
King Richard, who reigned until recently upon us, was through the treason of others mercilessly slain and murdered to this city's great sadness.
Henry Tudor would have been unknown to most of the population of England. So far from being a popular hero, it would have been a case of Henry who? And many people found it difficult to accept this Welsh adventurer in the early years as their king.
People felt that once he had won at Bosworth, he had to be, in a sense, allowed to be successful, because to oppose Henry would bring another generation of civil war, which nobody, apart perhaps from a few diehard Ricardians, really wanted. So Henry's position at the outset was possibly stronger than has often been assumed.
Henry Tudor was crowned Henry VII at Westminster on the 30th of October 1485. The following year, in fulfillment of his promise to his Yorkist allies, he married Elizabeth of York, the daughter of the Yorkist King Edward IV.
Henry Tudor's marriage to Elizabeth of York, daughter of Edward IV and sister of the princes in the Tower, seems to have been extremely popular, essentially because it promised peace. It promised a bringing together of the families who had been in conflict for the last decades. Of course, it didn't ensure security. That would only come once a family had been born, once Henry had survived long enough to pass on the throne to an adult heir, and that obviously would take 20 years, and those 20 years took a long time in passing.
The marriage was probably viewed as being extremely overdue, and that Henry was very slow to make good his promise. It took place almost 5 months after Bosworth, and consternation grew when the Queen was not crowned until November 1487. Evidently, Henry wanted to be known as a king in his own right, by conquest and by hereditary claim, and not merely as the husband of a predecessor's daughter.
And so, after almost 30 years of sporadic but bloody civil wars, of treachery and intrigue, and of weak and transient government, the houses of York and Lancaster were finally united in a new and vigorous dynasty. A final rebellion contrived by die-hard Yorkists was successfully put down by the new Tudor regime at the Battle of Stoke in 1487. The Wars of the Roses were finally over. Although no one could have known it at the time, England had seen the first faltering steps of what would eventually become one of its greatest dynasties. The long century of Tudor rule would see the authority of the English crown restored, a religious reformation, and an era of bold adventurism that would be the stepping stone to empire. The newfound domestic stability had been won with the blood of thousands of common men who had done battle at places such as St. Albans, Barnet, Towton, and Bosworth. Battles and executions had decimated the old nobility of England, and it had taken the death of a king, the second and last English king to die on the battlefield, to bring the Wars of the Roses to an end.